In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Before we study God's Word together, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand His holy book. Father in heaven, as we open Your holy Word and begin to study it, we earnestly pray that Your Spirit will teach us the truth and open the eyes of our understanding and, Lord, destroy our prejudices so that we might approach Your book with an open mind and so that Your Holy Spirit might teach us what we need to know. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It's going to be quite a little while before I can talk to you about the subject that I would like to talk to you about today. First of all, before we get started again, I want to just read a couple of Bible texts. I was lying in my bed early this morning when it was dark thinking about these texts and said to myself, Lord, I don't want to preach about these texts. I'm not going to preach about these texts today. I hope that I never have to. I told the Lord this morning, I said, I don't want to ever have to preach about these texts. But they are in the Bible. Look in your Bible in Genesis, the 6th chapter. I'll just read two texts. Genesis 6:3. The first part says, the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever. Notice, the Holy Spirit does not strive with mankind forever. Now look at one other text in the New Testament. This is even worse. Acts, the seventh chapter, verse 51. You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you. I was praying this morning. I said, Lord, I don't want to ever have to preach about that. I don't want to have to preach about those texts. And I'm not going to preach about that today. But let me tell you, friends, there are people throughout the Second Advent movement that are doing this. And that's why we see absolute spiritual destruction in our families and in our churches and in our sisterhoods of churches. And let me just say this much. When the time comes that the Holy Spirit doesn't strive anymore, if I have unconfessed, unrepented of sins, on sins that I've not forsaken, then it's all over. It's not just that way with me, it's that way in a church. And if I'm in that situation, or if I'm one of the people that want to control other people in the church or my family, I'm lost. It's that simple. You can read it in the book Desire of Ages. When the devil sinned, what did he want to do? He wanted control. It's still one of our problems. Well, let's pray that we don't ever have to preach that. I don't want to ever have to preach it. I do receive a lot of advice about what I should preach. I suppose when somebody hears that, they're going to say, well, you need it. I actually am thankful that I receive a lot of advice. And when I receive advice, I pray about it and say, Lord, do I need to preach about that? Sometimes people get very upset because they have written me a letter and they, about 6 months or a year later, they said, I wrote you this letter and you haven't preached about this. Well, the problem is that I'm a Protestant. And so I can only preach something that I am convicted about. That I'm convicted is the truth. And that I'm convicted that the Lord wants me to say at that time. So, I am going to make a few brief remarks before we get to our main subject, which I've tried to make as short as possible. I'm going to make a few brief remarks about a couple of subjects that there are many Adventists that are very concerned about today, and they're writing me letters and calling on the phone, and they say, you just have to preach about this. The first one is dress. And so, very quickly, I'm not going to preach a sermon about dress, but very quickly, I'm going to give you a little sketch, 7 points about dress, very, very quickly. Number one, dress is never to be a test among God's people again. It was at one time, but it is never to be a test among God's people again. Ellen White said, the Sabbath question that will come to this whole, was a question that will come to the whole world. Satan would be pleased to get up issues now to divert the minds of the people and get them into controversy over the subject of dress. And I'm very sorry that the devil has been so successful at what he has been doing. Ellen White cautioned persons who carry matters to extreme not to make the dress question a test of Christian fellowship. That's point number one. Point number two. Ellen White said, do not let the subject of dress fill the mind. Don't get so obsessed with this. They were obsessed with it in her day. That's point number two. Here's point number three. Even though this is not a test question, we should not allow our minds to get all absorbed in it. The Bible does say some things about it, and we should know what the Bible says about it. So here's several points very quickly. Point number three. Is according to Bible prophecy, pride of dress will be a major problem among God's people in the last days. You can study it for yourself. Look in Isaiah 3 and 4. And that is serious because if I have pride in my heart, if the reason I wear what I wear is because I have pride in my heart, I'm not going to heaven. The Bible says in Malachi 4:1, all the proud are going to burn up someday. Point number four. Point number four is the Bible teaches modesty of dress. Here's text. You can look up the text yourself. I'm not going to read it. The Bible teaches modesty of dress. Here are texts. Genesis 3, Exodus 20, 26, 1 Peter 3, 1 to 4. 1 Timothy 2, 9 and 10. Revelation 3, 17. And Revelation 16, 15. Now, probably somebody's, I know it's people say, they say, oh, you have to spell it out. No, friend, I do not have to spell it out. You should be able to figure this out from studying your Bible. However, if you'd say to me, I can't figure it out, I have to have some more information, here's the more information. Here's where you look. Look in Volume 1, Testimonies for the Church, page 456 and page 521, and read those areas. Or in Volume 4, page 628, and the next pages, and you'll get things spelled out so that a third grader can understand. Okay. What number was that? What? Okay, we're ready for five. Thank you. We're ready for number five. The Bible teaches that we should dress in a healthful manner. Let me read you just one text on this one because it's a text that's improperly translated in many people's Bibles and a lot of people don't understand it. So let me read you a literal translation of Proverbs 31:21. This is about the wise woman. It says, she is not afraid of snow for her household is clothed with double garments. Her household is clothed in double garments in the winter. Now, in our society, in the wintertime, as in general, women do not wear enough clothing, and that's deleterious to their health. But in our society, men in general do wear too much clothing in the summertime. And that's deleterious for their health too. One's as bad as the other. It causes improper circulation. After the flood, the descendants of Ham moved south. The descendants of Japheth moved north. They lived in areas of the world that we call today northern Russia, Poland. They went to Sweden, Norway. And there in these cold climates, women invented a new style of dress to keep their legs warm in the winter. We call that style of dress pants or trousers today. Women invented it for themselves in the winter. But it was such a functional garment. It was so practical and so utilitarian. Such a practical form of dress that men adopted it. And today in Western countries, most men wear pants or trousers 12 months of the year. However, if you are a woman living in Maine or Wisconsin or northern Minnesota or North Dakota or Montana or in the mountains in Wyoming, then you are going to need to wear lined pants in the winter if you are going to stay adequately warm. When you go outside, if you decide not to do that, that's your business. Perhaps in that case, it would be well for you to be polite and courteous to the Lord and not become a hypocrite by claiming that you're a health reformer. Point number five in regard to dress. A great problem in the world Jesus predicted in regard to dress was that his professed children would lack consideration for the poor. Jesus said that when he returned that he would say to those in his right hand, I was naked and you clothed me. And he will say to those on the left hand, I was naked and you did not clothe me. You didn't give me any clothing. And then, next point. Deuteronomy 22:5. The Bible does not define what masculine dress is or feminine dress is, but it says the man is not supposed to wear a woman's garment, a woman's not supposed to wear a man's garment. And every society or culture defines what a masculine or feminine garment is. And the Lord expects you to have reason and be able to figure that out. But I'm sorry to say that many people who believe that they are dress reformers cannot seem to get it figured out. In 1936, Katarengoso came from the Solomon Islands to the United States to attend the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. He was dressed like a minister or professional man dresses in the Solomon Islands, in his home country. We used to call them fuzzy wuzzies. He had what we would call today an Afro hairstyle. He was clean shaven. He was wearing a very nice looking dress suit. I have seen him myself in this dress suit, in the dress suit. But the bottom of his suit was a skirt, not pants, which was customary for professional men to wear in the Solomon Islands, in his society or culture. And so the women at the General Conference in the United States said, is this person a woman or a man? And so he got up in front of the whole General Conference in 1936 and he said, I am a man. And he never had to make an announcement like that in the Solomon Islands because he was dressed like men dressed over there and everybody knew. So you see, Deuteronomy 22:5 does not define what is masculine or feminine. In clothes, it just tells you that when you walk out of the door of your house in your society or culture, people should be able to instantly tell whether you're a man or a woman. And then the last point, which is actually the most important point of all in regard to dress, and that is, if I am a Christian, my goal in life will be to always dress in a way that will bring honor to my Redeemer and not bring dishonor to Him. Paul said, whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. Now, maybe you're not surprised to know that dress isn't the only thing that I get a lot of advice about, what I'm supposed to preach about. Another thing that I'm getting a lot of communications about recently, and people want say, you need to preach about this, is the subject of the King of the North. And after prayer and contemplation, I've decided that I'm not going to preach a whole sermon on the King of the North. Not because I haven't studied it, but because I have more important things that I need to preach about. However, I'm going to take enough minutes, which I hope is just a few, to talk about the King of the North so that you can figure it out on your own and make up your own mind. Now, in giving you this information, I am not going to disclose exactly what I myself believe about this subject, because I do not believe exactly the same as either one of the main interpretations or understanding of this subject. But I have studied this subject off and on for nearly 50 years. And I am certainly able to tell you the two most prominent views, and then you can study it out for yourself. The view held by nearly all pioneer Adventists, as far as I've been able to examine, is very similar to the view that was held by Uriah Smith. And in brief, it is as follows. The power being described as the King of the North in Daniel 11:40-45 is the Muslim power, which then at that time was headquartered in Turkey. And this was the view of Seventh-day Adventists until about the mid-1940s. For example, see if I can find some material here. Here it is. This is the Sabbath School Lesson Quarterly for the Seventh-day Adventist Church, International Sabbath School Quarterly, for the first quarter of 1904, and the subject of this Sabbath School Quarterly is the prophecies of Daniel. Now, this is from the General Conference, Sabbath School Quarterly, and I'm going to read to you what they thought. This is in the lesson about Armageddon, and I'm going to read to you what they quote here from a Turkish newspaper. Here's what it says. We shall do our utmost, these are Muslims speaking from Turkey, that's what they say. We shall do our utmost to keep England's support, but at last if we do not succeed in it, then it is very easy to know what we have to do. When Europe will not look at us, then we shall lay aside all the European customs which we have adopted and enter on our old way from the boy of 13 to the old man of 75. Every one of us will be armed, and we shall defend by the will of God and by the daring of the old days the country we have held for 500 years. And if the issue should come to this, as Islamism is not confined to Turkey, then we will blend all the different Muslim races into one. The Muslims of India, of Central Asia, of the Caucasus, of Africa, and of Algeria will come forward, and we shall again take measures which we once adopted for the conquest of Jerusalem. We shall send proclamations everywhere and declare a general war against Christendom. Then it will not be possible to subjugate 120 million Muslims. It was 120 million then, it's over a billion today. It will not be possible to subjugate 120 million Muslims by 90 million soldiers. If the Muslims all over the world rise to defend their sacred religion, and if the treasure accumulated every year at Mecca is disposed of for the protection of the Mohammedan faith, then the scenes of ancient European wars where the Muslims were both victorious and destructive will be repeated, and the progress and civilization of centuries will be destroyed. That was the historic Adventist position, and for that reason, if you read Daniel 11:45, Daniel 12:1, the historic Adventists believe that when that happened, that would signal the close of probation. That would be when Michael would stand up, because it says he will come to his end and none will help him, and during that time Michael will stand up. That is, begin to reign. So, Adventists for 100 years believed that that event would signal the close of probation. However, in the middle 1940s, I have lots of material on that, but we must cut it short. In the middle 1940s, some Seventh-day Adventist ministers decided that this whole situation needed to be restudied. And one of the leaders that restudied this was an Adventist minister in Australia by the name of Louis F. Weir. Here's his book. He wrote about it, King of the North of Jerusalem. Right at the beginning here, he signed the foreword, Louis F. Weir, Melbourne, Victoria, Australia, May 11, 1949. That's when this book was written. It's over a 100-page book. And he said, no, we've been wrong all this time. The King of the North absolutely cannot be Turkey or the Muslim powers. He talks about that over and over again in here. The King of the North is the papacy. And so he introduced that view into Adventist thinking. It came to Pacific Union College, and from Pacific Union College it spread to all the Adventist colleges all over North America. And that has become the predominant view among Adventists today. However, as you would expect, there, of course, have been a backlash against the new view ever since it first developed. And this backlash is getting stronger and stronger, and I'm getting more and more mail about it. For instance, here's a new book that just came out by Citadel Ministries called The Final Waymark of Probationary Time. And he says, look, what you've been teaching for the last 50 years about the King of the North is all wrong. The original position was the right one. This is not the only book that's just come out in the last little bit about this. It says, Restoring the True Pioneer Position of the King of the North. That's what this book is about. And then there was a well-known Seventh-day Adventist evangelist by the name of George Burnside, and he wrote a book several years ago called The King of the North is Not the Papacy. So this has been very, very controversial in Adventist thought, and I don't know why so many people are writing me letters thinking that I'm supposed to straighten this all out. You study for yourself, and you decide. By the way, I have very good friends on both sides of the issue. I know Adventist ministers, very sincere, conscientious, dedicated Adventist ministers on both sides of this issue. You'll have to study it out and decide what you think. Now, we're done with the preliminaries. You ready? We want to study now what's really important. You know, if you happen to make the wrong decision so that you're mixed up on who the King of the North is, that won't cause you to be lost. I would hope. If you don't understand the dress issue just the way somebody else does in Adventism, that doesn't mean that you will be lost. It doesn't mean that you'll be saved either. But I want to study with you for a few minutes what really is important. And this is why some people can't get this figured out. They can't figure out, why don't you study more? Why don't you study about dress and the King of the North and this and this? Friends, I'm interested in all those things, but what I'm most interested in is what's most important. And what's most important is, are you going to be in the kingdom of heaven or not? What is really important is, are you ready for Jesus to come? Am I ready for Jesus to come? That's what's important. More important. So whatever view you hold concerning the King of the North or concerning appropriate dress wouldn't do you any good if the Lord should come and you're not ready. So as I was thinking about this, I finally just narrowed it down to one thing. So I want to study with you for a few minutes. What is the one big reason? Now there's lots of other reasons. I'm certainly not contradicting that. There's lots of other reasons. But what is the one big reason that so many professed Christians will not be ready for the Lord to come? Okay, here's point number one on that subject. If you are going to be ready for the Lord to come, you must be an overcomer. Does the Bible teach that? Well, read Revelation 2 and 3. Every single church Not one is missed. Every single church, all seven churches, and the seven churches represent the whole Christian world for all time. To every church, salvation is promised to the overcomer. Look at Revelation 21. Revelation 21, starting with verse 5. We'll read verses 5 to 7. I enjoy reading verses 5 to 7. I enjoy reading verse 4, and I do not enjoy reading verse 8. Let's read verses 5 to 7. Then he who sat on the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega. That's the first and last letter of the Greek alphabet. That's, in other words, I'm the beginning and the end. Next phrase says, the beginning and the end. I will give of the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. He who overcomes shall inherit all things. And I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Who is it that's going to inherit everything? Who is it that's going to be given everything? It's the one that overcomes. Salvation is for the one that overcomes. Now, we're living in a pessimistic age. In the 19th century, in Ellen White's time, it was an optimistic age. And people used to say, I used to laugh as a child when my father used to tell me about how people used to talk. I just could hardly believe it. Do you realize that there were people that used to say, they used to stand in front of the mirror and say, every day, in every way, I'm getting better and better. And they would say that to themselves over and over again, and they thought if they said it enough, it would actually happen. They would get better and better. And my father told me what people used to say. I thought, what trash, what craziness. How could people be so foolish in just one generation back? And the fact of the matter is, they thought they could do it because they lived in a time of optimism because of all their new inventions. They thought they were going to conquer disease, conquer war. They were going to have all they were going to live in a utopian society. That's what they thought in the 19th century. The 20th century, after we had a couple of world wars, that destroyed all that. And we have become a very pessimistic people around the world. And so people say today, and they say to preachers, they say, I can't overcome. And preachers are affected, just like other people, by the society in which they live. And so preachers, by the way, we don't have time. But you can study it out for yourself. This is not really important. In the 19th century, preachers adjusted their preaching to suit the tenor of what people were thinking. And that's where the doctrine of perfectionism comes from. And by the way, Ellen White never endorsed that. Seventh-day Adventists do not teach perfectionism. We have never taught it. Perfectionism is the idea you just come to Christ and bang, you be perfect right in. From then on, you're just perfect. That's what they thought then. Now we've gone clear to the other extreme. Instead of saying, just come to Christ and accept Jesus, you'll be perfect instantly, people say, oh, you can. You'll never be able to make it. Nobody's perfect. Nobody can be perfect. And yet the Bible teaches Christian perfection. Let me explain to you why people get so discouraged because they cannot overcome. The reason that people get so discouraged because they can't overcome is because they do not have the Holy Spirit. The Apostle Paul is exceedingly clear about this. Read Romans 6. Read especially Romans 8. The reason people cannot overcome is because they do not have the Holy Spirit. And the Lord Jesus said that the Father is more willing to give the Holy Spirit to you than parents are to give good gifts to their children. Now, if you're a parent, do you like to give good gifts to your children? And God is more willing to give people the Holy Spirit than parents are to give good gifts to their children. Well, if that's the case, why is it these people can't overcome because they don't have the Holy Spirit? Well, the reason they are not able to receive the Holy Spirit is because they are unwilling to make an undivided commitment to God. Shall I read that to you from the Bible? Look in Luke, the 14th chapter. Luke 14:33. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Unless you are willing to make an unreserved, undivided commitment to God, to follow Him, to obey Him, you cannot receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will keep pleading with you. But the Holy Spirit can't work in your life. Because the Holy Spirit never, ever works contrary to your will. We need to understand this, friends. The Holy Spirit will never work contrary to your will. And in order for the Holy Spirit to do everything that the Holy Spirit wants to do in your life, your will has to be totally surrendered to God. And if you haven't done that, well, then you're stuck. You're stuck. And that's why people get discouraged in their Christian walk. They say, I can't overcome. That's true. They can't overcome. The reason they can't overcome is because they don't have the Holy Spirit. Why don't they have the Holy Spirit? Because they have not made an undivided, unreserved surrender to God. Well, now let's go one step further. If they haven't made an undivided, unreserved surrender to God, why haven't they done that? I mean, why? If that's the way you get the Holy Spirit, why don't people do it? Well, here's why. The reason people are not willing to make an undivided commitment to give their undivided affections to God is because they don't know Him. And because they don't know Him, they don't love Him and they don't trust Him. How can you make an unreserved surrender to somebody that you don't know and you don't trust and you don't love? How can you do that? Would you want somebody to marry you if they didn't know you and didn't love you and didn't trust you? Would you want that? And so people can't make an undivided surrender to the Lord because they don't know Him, they don't love Him, and they don't trust Him. How come they don't know Him and they don't love Him? And that, my friend, is what faith is all about. One time, if you want to read it in a book, it's in the book Patriarchs and Prophets, about page 657. Ellen White says, every failure on the part of the children of God is because of their lack of faith. Every failure. If you have faith, you can get everything you need. It doesn't matter how weak you are, how sinful you are, whatever your problem is. If you have faith in God, the plan of salvation, He's going to make it work out in your life. Every failure on the part of the children of God is because of their lack of faith. I tremble when I read that. And I say, Lord, I've been praying. I say, Lord, the disciples prayed this prayer, so I don't think it's wrong to pray. You remember the disciples came to the Lord one time and they said, Lord, increase our faith. You remember that? Have you ever prayed that prayer? Well, let's take it one step further. This is the final step we're going to take today. Why is it that people don't have faith in God so that they make an unreserved surrender to Him, so they make an unreserved, undivided commitment to Him, so that they give Him their heart, their undivided affections? Why do they not have the faith so that they can do that? We read the answer in our scripture reading today. If you turn to Romans, the 10th chapter, we read verses 6 to 17 in our scripture reading today. And it explains here why there's some people that don't have any faith. And if you don't have any faith and you don't know God, then you can't make a commitment with God, you're stuck. You can't receive the Holy Spirit, you're just stuck. Well, how are you going to get the faith you need so that you can be saved? Look at verse 17. It says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. How are you going to get the faith that you need so that you can know God, so that you can make the commitment to Him, so that you can receive the Holy Spirit, so that the plan of salvation can work out in your life? How are you going to get the faith you need? How does faith come? What does it say? Faith comes by what? Hearing. Hearing what? The Word of God. It's not the 1st of January, but it is very close to the 1st of the year. It is not too late for you to make a decision that you, if you haven't done it before, that you are going to get on a serious and systematic Bible study program this year. Now, just think to yourself, maybe there's somebody in this congregation right now that maybe you have never even read your Bible through. Now, if you're 6 years old, I would expect that you have never read your Bible through. When I was 6 years old, I hadn't read my Bible through either. I didn't start reading the Bible through until I was 7. But if you're an adult and you have never read the Bible through, wouldn't it be a good idea to decide that this year you're going to read it through? Find out what the Lord says about life and everything? Maybe you've read the Bible through several times. The problem is, just reading the Bible is not enough. I have seen people, in fact, I was present at a meeting about, well, it was over 50 years ago now. I was present at a meeting where a man stood up and he said, he said he had read the Bible through 99 times. He was reading the Bible through for the 100th time. And so the preacher asked this man, he said, well, how much of the Bible do you have left to read so that you've read the Bible through 100 times? And the man said, I have to read yet Revelation 22. So he said, well, why don't you read it out loud here to the congregation? They can hear you as you finish reading through the Bible through 100 times. So he read it there to us. He read Revelation 22 out loud, and he had read the Bible through 100 times. And that's fine. Some people, the way they learn best is by reading something over and over again. Some people have read certain chapters. I'm sure that I've read certain chapters hundreds of times. However, it is not enough just to read. Let me show you that from the Bible itself. Turn in your Bible to Psalm 119. Psalm 119. Verse 11. It says, your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. What is David talking about here? He's saying, I have memorized the Scripture, and because so that I will not sin, I have memorized the Scripture. In the book Great Controversy, about page 600, Ellen White says that there are many people that they find temptations irresistible because when the devil comes to them with temptation, they don't have any weapons to fight the devil with. When the devil came to Jesus, how did Jesus fight the devil? What did Jesus answer when the devil tempted him? He didn't even use his own words. He said, it is written. Now, you can't say it is written if you can't quote it. Does that make sense to you? If you want to win in your Christian life, you need to have some scriptures memorized. So, in the last few minutes that we're together, I want to just point out some scriptures that it would be very helpful for you to study and some of them to memorize if you have not done it before. Somebody's going to be overwhelmed by this first one, I know. But I'm going to ask the question anyway. This is number one. Have you memorized the Sermon on the Mount? I memorized the Sermon on the Mount before I was out of high school. Somebody says, oh, 3 chapters? How could I ever do that? Well, you probably already have some of it memorized. Can you say the Lord's Prayer? That's in the Sermon on the Mount. So you've already memorized 4 verses. Do you know the Golden Rule? Matt, that's in the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 7:12. Jesus said, do to others the way you would like them to do to you. I think about that scripture very often. In fact, I was just reading, I think it was last night, doing some recreational reading in the Spirit of Prophecy. If I do not learn to do to others the way I would like for them to do to me, I will not be in the kingdom of heaven. Did you know that? You see, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus specifies in very clear language who will be saved and who will be lost. He specifies in very clear language. I don't know how anybody can misunderstand. Do you want to know for sure which kind of people will be saved and which kind of people will be lost? Do you want to know that for sure? The Sermon on the Mount is as good a place in the Bible as you can go. The Sermon on the Mount, by the way, is mainly a sermon about the Ten Commandments. Jesus preached a lot about the Ten Commandments. Most of the Sermon on the Mount is about the Ten Commandments. Now, nobody's going to hold it against you if you don't memorize the whole Sermon on the Mount in a week or two, but if you started in, before this year's out, you could say the Sermon on the Mount. It would, if you have never memorized it, it would be a great spiritual blessing to you. Remember, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And when you put the Word of God in your mind, it has effect on the way you think and the way you feel, and it starts having an effect on the way you act, and so that you can make an unreserved commitment to the Lord and receive the Holy Spirit and start having victory in your life. Here's a second one, point number two. Have you memorized 1 Corinthians 13? I don't read 1 Corinthians 13 every day anymore, but if I don't read it, I quote it to myself. I love to quote it to myself. I know the different translations of the words. I've gone over it. And when I was in Australia, in 1988, I was in a Seventh-day Adventist family home, and they asked me in the morning worship if I would conduct the morning worship for them. So I had my Greek New Testament with me, and I just read to them a literal translation of 1 Corinthians 13. I translated as we went along. They were surprised. They said, "Oh, I didn't know that. Do you know what every word means in 1 Corinthians 13? It's one of the most important chapters for a Christian to understand. Paul spells out 15 different characteristics of love. So all 15 of those characteristics should be in my life if I'm a Christian. Here's number three. I hope that there are not very many people here that this would apply to. But if it applies to you, you need to get started right away. And the question is, have you memorized the Ten Commandments? Have you memorized the Ten Commandments? A child of 7 or 8 years old can memorize the Ten Commandments. We should all be able to quote the Ten Commandments. We should know exactly what the words mean. Here's number four. This is not so much an assignment to memorize a certain text, but this question. Do you know where all 10 of the Ten Commandments are repeated in the New Testament? Do you know that? Do you know where all 10 of the Ten Commandments are repeated in the New Testament? And they're repeated as a divine obligation. We should know that. Someday we might have to answer for that in a court of justice. Number five. Do you know the three angels' messages? I don't remember now whether I was 11 or 12 years old when I first memorized the three angels' messages. And I will confess, when I first memorized them, I did not understand all about them. I've been studying the three angels' messages for a major part of my life. The three angels' messages contain God's last invitation of mercy to a planet that is in rebellion. And as we approach the end of the world, the eternal destiny of every single person in the world will be determined by whether that person accepts or rejects the three angels' messages. Since that is the case, should we know what those messages say? Should we be able to explain them? Yes, we should. Number six. Have you studied carefully the final instructions Jesus gave to His disciples before their crucifixion? Now, this instruction is so important, so precious, so wonderful, it would do you well if you could memorize it. But it's a fairly long passage, and you may decide that you're so weak-minded that you can't. But by the way, if you're feeling that way, let me remind you that the Waldensee young people used to memorize the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of John, both. Those final instructions that Jesus gave to his disciples before his crucifixion are found in John 13 to John 17. It's in John 13 where Jesus said, "This is the way that everybody's going to know whether or not you're disciples to me. This is the way." It's John 13. And then 14, 15, 16, 17. Wonderful, wonderful instruction and information. John 17, by the way, is one of the clearest chapters in the whole Bible that describes the mediatorial work of Christ in our behalf in heaven. We get a preview of what he was going to do after his resurrection in John 17. Okay, and then here's several others quickly. Number 7, is your life in harmony with the divine commands given in 2 Corinthians 6:14 to 2 Corinthians 7:1? Specific commands to Christians there. Is your life in harmony with the divine commands given in 2 Corinthians 6:14 to 7:1? Number 8. Is your life in harmony with Paul's instruction about Christian living in Romans 12? He specifies over 30. I think I misspoke. I don't think I should have said over 30. I should have said 40. He specifies at least 40 different characteristics of the Christian life. Romans 12. By the way, Romans 12 is simply a sermon that the Apostle Paul gave one time that's recorded. Number 9. Are you avoiding the wrong practices that the Apostle Paul says will bar you from the kingdom of God? What are the wrong practices that the Apostle Paul says that will bar you from the kingdom of God? Well, here's the text. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 and 10. Ephesians 5, 3 to 6. Colossians 3, 5 and 6. Romans 1, 28 to 32. And Romans 2, 8 and 9. Number 10. Are you seeking to climb Peter's ladder? That's 2 Peter 1, 3 to 7. And number 11. Are you developing the grace of brotherly love that John talks about over and over again in 1 John 2 to 5? And finally, number 12, are you attempting to become perfect in speech, as James admonishes us in James 3? Will there be a group of people that will be like this described in these scriptures? There will be. The Lord is going to have a group of people at the end that are without fault before the throne of God. You can read it in Revelation 14:5. Paul talked about it in Ephesians 5. Jesus talked about it. All the apostles talk about it. And we're living in the time when it's going to happen. The question is, am I going to be part of it? And so James says, toward the end of his book, as he's given much instruction for being ready the judgment, he says to the people, the book of James, by the way, was written especially for people that live in the last days. He says in James 5, he says, the judge is at the door. My dear friend, Jesus came to this world to save you, to save every member of the human race that was willing to be saved. He came to this world the first time as a Savior. He did not come as a judge. But let me tell you something. When he comes the second time, he's not coming as a Savior. He's coming as a judge. You'll already have been saved or you'll never be saved. The Bible teaches that very clearly in the book of Revelation. And that time is rapidly approaching. Before the door of mercy, the door of probation shuts, Would it be well for us this year to say, Lord, I am serious. I'm going to pray every day. I'm going to study your word every day. I'm going to seek to bring my life into harmony with what I read in your book. I'm going to make an unreserved commitment. Lord, I want to receive the Holy Spirit so that I can have victory in my life. If you follow the directions, the Lord never fails to do his part. Let's pray before we close. Father in heaven, we pray that you will help us, that we may not be diverted off onto other issues that are not of supreme importance. Help us to concentrate on what is most important since we have so little time. Help each one of us as we study your word that we might memorize it, that we might memorize the promises, the commands, and the injunctions. And Lord, as we choose to make an unreserved surrender of our life to you, we pray that you will honor our request by and our decision by giving to us the Holy Spirit to change us. Lord, we need so much changing, but we're trusting that you can do it. And we pray that your Holy Spirit may come into our hearts and minds and transform us in character so that we will be ready for that awesome secret closure when the door of probation closes. We pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org. And our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.